A quick note about this podcast. Information is provided for educational purposes only and is not intended to include or constitute financial product advice. You should obtain independent advice from an Australian Financial Services licensee before making any investment decisions. Please refer to ASX's full disclaimer with respect to this podcast on the school's Share Market Game teacher resources page on the ASX website.
Welcome to a new podcast series of ASX's School Share Market Game. My name is Teresa Lindfeldt. I am the Senior Manager, Enterprise Marketing, Brand and Content at ASX, and I'm also responsible for the Share Market Game. In this series, we cover the theme of investing advice for my teenage self, and we talk to some investment experts who will share how they got involved in investing, what they were like as teenagers, and what they wish they knew about investing now that they are older and wiser. We hope that this content will spark your curiosity and continue your investment journey as you start learning about the share market, how to invest, and different types of investments. Today, we are delighted to welcome to our podcast Chris Brycki, who is the founder and CEO of Stockspot. Welcome, Chris, to our podcast.
Thanks for having me on.
Chris has appeared on the Share Market Game before. He's done some videos for us, and his journey with investing actually started 20 years ago when his father started teaching him how shares worked. And he was also the winner of the Share Market Game when he played as a schoolboy. And that led to him starting Stockspot and really having a great interest in all things finance. So Stockspot, tell us a little bit about Stockspot and what it does, Chris.
Sure. Well, Stockspot's a long way away from my first experiences trading with the school share game. It's actually a business that helps people invest in a very gradual way over the long run. So it has nothing to do with trading. And what we do is help people invest into a portfolio of exchange traded funds or ETFs. And these are these fantastic instruments that are listed on the ASX and allow you to spread your money across lots of different assets. And so we look after about 13,000 people in Australia and manage their portfolios to keep them steady and balanced, to give them opportunities for growth and dividends, and also to take a lot of the hassles away from investing. Because for some people, it's a fun hobby to get really involved in picking shares or working out when to buy and sell. But there's a lot of others I realized growing up that actually want to be investing but don't want to spend that much time investigating markets. And so our product is really for those sorts of people that want to grow their wealth but not spend a lot of time doing it.
Yeah, absolutely. Back to the share market game. So it's obviously been a bit of a journey for you, but I think we've spoken before about how your dad introduced you to the concept of shares. I mean, obviously, there's now quite a heavy focus on ETFs, but tell us a little bit about how you started out getting interested and, you know, how you've landed up where you are today.
Sure. Well, the investing world was quite different when I first was introduced to the market. So I was lucky when I was about 10 or 11 years old. My dad, who wasn't in finance, he's got a medical background, but he opened a newspaper for me and showed me the share market section and started to explain that you could own a part of a business. And to me, that sounded very interesting and exciting. And he gave a few examples of, you know, Woolworths, where we did our shopping, or at the time, Billabong, where I had a lot of their surf gear. And so he allowed me to pick a share to invest in and said he'd put, I think at the time it was $1,000 into that share and allow me to track the share price. So that got me hooked pretty early. This was back in 1996, 1997. And I was a pretty young kid, but I studied the paper for a while. I used to sit in dad's office and he would get a fax. And I'm not sure whether all the young listeners would have ever seen a fax before, but you used to be able to receive a message before the internet on this piece of paper that would come through a machine. And he'd get a fax from his stockbroker every night with the share prices. And every day I'd be reading and learning more about all of these businesses. And eventually, as an 11-year-old kid, I bought my first share, which was a mining share, and started to learn about what different businesses do and how they make profit and how they share dividends with their investors. And that really led me on what the journey has now been, I think, 26 years since then, or even a little bit longer, learning about the share market, being involved quite heavily on the trading side for my first jobs, and now starting Stockspot as an online investing business.
And obviously you were one of the winners. I think you were one of the few people who managed to win the school share market game several times. So that must have been quite an influence for you. Tell us about that experience for you.
Well, I think I first entered the game when I joined high school. So in year seven, I had already got a bit of interest in shares when I was in year five and six at primary school. And I learned about this share game, which had been going on, I think, since the 1970s. But this was 1998. And I think it had just gone online either that year or the year before. And so you could register over the internet. And the internet was relatively new for people at that point. Register your team and then buy and sell shares over the internet. Now, at my school, there weren't actually any other people entering this competition. So I remember I had to go to the ASX website, download the entry forms, and actually find a teacher at my school who wanted to sponsor me because no one else was actually doing it. So I remember I got the social science teacher, whose name was Mr. Pillay, to sign off on my form and allow me to enter the competition. And then over a few years, the interest from our school definitely changed. So from being the only person that entered, as you mentioned, I was very lucky and won the game, I think when I was in year eight for the first time. And after that happened, a lot of the year 12 and a year 11 boys from my school thought, well, if some young year eight kid can win this, I better give it a go because it must be pretty easy to do this and earn a bit of extra pocket money. So I think we probably had a few hundred students participate by the time I was later on in my school years. And it came a pretty big thing in our school for learning about business studies and economics, and it became essentially part of our school course.
Yeah, I think it's probably gone from strength to strength. We now have over 70,000 kids participating every year, so it's a great tool for schools to use. Now, you obviously were lucky. You had a father who gave you the opportunity to invest through his account. Thinking back, you know, you're obviously older and wiser now. What do you wish you knew about investing when you were a teenager and perhaps even when you were playing the school share market game for the first time?
Well, I think the school share game definitely teaches you a lot of skills and knowledge about investing. You know, it teaches you about the sorts of companies that are listed on the share market and that shares move up and down, you know, on a daily basis. It also teaches you that in order to do really well in the share market, you essentially have to take some big risks. And that's what I learned in the game, that in order to win it, you couldn't really take a sensible approach of spreading your money across lots of companies. You really had to bet big and bet hard and guess which of the sectors or shares were going to do well over that 10-week period. I learned a lot in the share game about risk management, around, you know, which shares move in the same direction and which ones move in the opposite direction, and a lot about trading, so getting in and out of shares in a short-term basis. I think what I wish I learned earlier, you know, in playing the share game, I probably had the false belief that, you know, when it comes to the share market, most companies do well over the long run and give their shareholders profits and grow in price. But after studying the share market for many more years, what I've realized is actually it's only quite a small proportion of companies that actually do really well over the long run. So there's been some fantastic studies done globally that have found only between 4-6% of all of the companies drive all of the wealth in the share market. So it's really important when you're investing that you have shares in those small number of companies that actually do really well. And as a young teenager, I think I got a lot of confidence trading shares through the original tech boom and made some money during that period, but then ultimately had to see a lot of it be lost again when share markets collapsed in 2001 and 2002. You know, that was quite a humbling and harrowing experience as a kid to lose all of your money. But you know, it also taught me that markets can move to extremes. So they can get extremely excited at some points and shares can go through the roof. And I think we've seen a repeat of that over the last couple of years in 2021. And shares really had a big boom and a lot of people made a lot of money. But shares can also see the other extreme. They can go down a lot and can go much further than you expect. And that happened to me in 2001 and 2002. A few of these technology shares that I owned then fell by like 98% or 99%. So shares can go down a long way as well. And I think if I had my time again back then, I would have, you know, probably realized that I needed to be locking in some of those profits when I made them and then spreading the money across other companies. And that's something that, yeah, we've embedded into the philosophy at the company I run now, Stockspot. What we do is actually rebalance people's portfolios, which is sell out of things that have done well, and then put the proceeds of that into shares that haven't done as well, because that actually helps to reduce your risk and ensure that you don't lose all of your money.
So you have got two children that might be a little bit too young to invest. How are you getting them to start going on the investment journey, you know, even if they are not quite of school age yet?
Well, I think from my experience growing up, I realized how important it is to teach kids about money and savings and, you know, good money habits generally. Like, I feel quite fortunate that my parents were very open to me about how, you know, different areas of personal finance work, whether it's, you know, how a mortgage works or a credit card or insurance or the share market. It's not something I think we learn enough about at schools. So even if you do commerce or business studies or economics, I think there's a lot of gaps that people miss out on. And it really comes down to parents teaching kids about these sorts of things. So I think all parents should be trying to educate themselves if they don't come from that sort of background, and then helping their kids, you know, learn these sort of habits. Like, kids have a wonderful advantage that they've got time on their side when it comes to investing. And you don't need to invest a huge amount to, you know, really enjoy amazing long-term growth because of the power of compounding, which is that you earn growth on your growth, and that leads to amazing returns over the long run. So I think for very young kids, like I have got a 2.5-year-old and a 4.5-year-old, the first habits you really want to be teaching kids is just about, you know, what money is, and that you can do jobs basically around the house and you can earn some pocket money, and then you can use money to buy the sorts of things that you might like to use. You can also use that money to invest, which means to grow that money further, or you could use that money to donate to help other people that are less fortunate. So there's different things that you can do with your money to help yourself or help others. And then different things you can do to help yourself today versus help yourself in the future. And I think it's a really important concept for kids to learn that sometimes if you make short-term sacrifices with your money, and that means not spending it today, but investing it, it leads to great rewards in the future. And so that's probably one of the next lessons I'll be teaching my boys is, you know, the lesson of discipline and not spending all of your money today, because when you invest in the share market, that money grows much larger. And if, you know, you sacrifice buying maybe another Lego toy this month, you might be able to buy a real car, you know, in 15 years time when you want one. So yes. I think that's a harder lesson, because kids love the tangible of today and being able to touch a toy or use some sort of play equipment today, rather than just see that money sort of sit there and do nothing.
Yeah, so a bit of delayed gratification, I think, which is hard.
Absolutely. I think in all areas of parenting. But yeah, that's one of the next lessons I'll be teaching my boys. So when they were born, I set for both of them up a Stockspot account from the company I run. I've thought it's always so important to teach kids about money that we don't charge any fees on kids' accounts before they reach 18 or they've at least amassed $10,000. And so I think it's a great thing for parents to do if they can afford to invest in some way in the share market and have those conversations with their kids, you know, when they get to the right age.
Yeah, and we spoke about this before the recording, that kids obviously have to have an account via their parents at this stage. Kids under 18 can't open their own accounts. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. So in Australia, kids can't invest, but their parents can. So we give our clients two different options. Either the parents can invest in their own names, either individually, or if it's a couple, you know, you can set up a joint account. Or for some families, they invest via a family trust. And so they're the two options for investing for kids. The tax that you have to pay on dividends ends up having to be paid by the parents, not the kids as well, which you need to be aware of. So, you know, we produce a simple tax statement each year that then the parent would need to provide to their accountant or put into my tax. But then you can still give your kids access to the app so they can check how their investments are going and start to talk to them about the sort of companies they're investing in. So. Yeah. For my boys, I think when they're a bit older, you know, when you invest into ETFs on the ASX, you get access to amazing global companies like Disney, And I know my boys are big fans of all of the Disney movies. So to be able to tell them that, you know, every time they watch some Disney movies or they buy some sort of Mandalorian toy from Target or Kmart, that actually they're going to earn some of the profits from what they purchased. You know, I think that's going to be a great conversation to have when they're old enough.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So just a last question for you is, we've got quite a few people who are starting to play the share market game at the moment, quite a few students. What is the one tip that you would give them this time around, you know, maybe looking at the current market conditions, but also just generally?
Well, I think I mentioned my tip a little bit earlier, but I might take a slight variation. I think the share game taught me that, you know, when it comes to winning in the short term in the share market, you need to bet big and you need to have some strong opinions and you need to back them. And that will either lead to great results and you're doing very well or doing very badly. But in any case, it's a great lesson to learn. And particularly when it's not real money, it's play money. It's a rather cheap lesson to learn. So when I was playing, and this was in the late 90s and early 2000s, you know, what I tried to do in the game was identify which sector of the share market I thought was going to perform well over those 10 weeks and try to discover all of the companies in that sector. And during that period, there was a period where technology shares were doing well. There was a period where biotechnology was doing well. And then later, there was a period where gold shares were doing well. So I think understanding the different sectors of the share market is really useful for people that are playing the game. You know, if you can go to the ASX website and drill down into different sectors to understand where these companies fit, what you'll find is that there's some sectors that are more volatile, which means their share prices go up and down faster. And they're the sectors that you probably are most interested in investing in for the share game, simply because it's a very short-term game and you need to have some volatility if you're going to win. The caveat to all of that is the strategy that you should employ in your real life investing. And certainly the philosophy that we share with our clients at Stockspot is that that isn't what you should be doing for long-term investing.
Well, I was going to ask you about that.
For long-term investing, it's very hard to beat the market by picking shares or sectors. And, you know, I tell our clients about a lot of that research that actually professional fund managers, and these are the people that are paid big bucks to pick stocks and time when to get in and out, 85% of them do worse than just investing into the broad share market over the long run. And so, you know, my advice for investing in the long run outside of the share game is actually just to go onto the ASX and buy a portfolio of different exchange traded funds, which are such fantastic instruments because they allow you to diversify, keep your fees low, which is really important. So more of your profits stay with you rather than go to the fund managers, and then allow you to just patiently earn the returns of the share market and compound from when you're young all the way through to when you need that money in the future. And so if I had my time again, I also would have made sure that most of my money was in these index funds growing up, and only a small part, maybe 10 or 20% of my money, was going into more speculative stocks, because that's a much more safer and sensible strategy. And I think, you know, in the share game, I won a few thousand dollars. Had I invested that in ETFs right now, I'd probably have a few hundred thousand dollars rather than having lost it and had to earn it again, you know, during work.
Yeah. And that's just a long-term strategy and the effects of compounding, I guess.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I think it's just such a powerful impact of compounding year after year, that if you can just earn 8 or 9 or 10% a year, which is historically what the share market has given you, from when you're in your 30s all the way through to retirement, you're going to have an enormous amount of money, and much more than having some up years that are up 50%, but then some years that are down 50%. You know, that sort of pathway, you know, one leads to a lot more stress and a lot more gray hairs for people, but then also doesn't lead to great wealth creation. So, you know, it's very much, you know, the story of the tortoise and the hare. You know, there's always going to be people out there looking for the faster ways to get rich, and, you know, talking about that cryptocurrency they bought that did well, or the mining stock they did that went up 10x. But for every person that makes money in those things, there's many more that lose money. My tip to people out there that are young is just, you know, be the tortoise, don't be the hare. Let everyone else brag about the short-term profits they've made, but know that over the long run, you're going to beat them because of the effects of compounding.
That's a fantastic insight. Thank you so much, Chris, for joining us. We really appreciate it. And I'm sure the listeners of this will gather the tips and hopefully do really well in their endeavors in the share market game. Thank you.
Yeah, my pleasure. And yeah, good luck to everyone playing this year and into the future. And yeah, you're welcome to reach out to me on social media if you have ever have questions or want ideas for strategies or want to run any ideas by me.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Chris.
Are you keen to learn more? Why not visit the ASX blog, asx.com.au/blog, for a wide range of articles, videos and insights from ASX experts, listed companies and investment professionals.